Okay, so in our last class, we left off kind of with our cliffhanger on The Wizard of Oz and Frank Baum. And my kind of statement that movie is about economics. So I kind of wanted just to finish up that story really quickly, and then we'll probably be finishing up our monetary policy section in general shortly after that today. So kind of backstory again, we're talking late 1800s, early 1900s, Chicago. Chicago was fairly agricultural based. And at the time, the United States was on the commodity standard. They were solely a gold standard economy. So what was happening, we were having farmers that would have to take out loans at the start of the year and use that money to plant their crop and sell their crop at the end of the year. In the late 1800s, early 1900s, the United States was experiencing severe deflation, especially in agricultural markets. So what we found was that the price that farmers thought they were going to receive in March when they planted their crop and the price they actually received in September when they harvested their crop was significantly lower. This caused our farmers not to be able to pay off those loans to banks. And banks thus then were capitalizing, and every year or whatever would end up foreclosing effectively on a portion of the farmer's land. So farms were getting smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. Banks were then selling this land off to industrialists to put up factories. So since most of Frank Baum's readers were farmers, he was kind of writing to his constituency. And like I mentioned last time, it was taboo to talk negatively about anyone in the government. So he made up all of these characters to elaborate on the situation. Frank Baum was very, very, very pro expanding the money supply. He felt that if we could create inflation in the country, it would be just like what we talked about last time, it would be good for borrowers. Remember, inflation makes it easier to pay off debt. So he was writing this story in kind of a way to try to convince society to that we needed to increase the money supply. So he came up with all of these characters, and I have a list, you can see a couple pages of it here, of who all the characters in his newspaper article represented. So of course, Dorothy, this is kind of a no-brainer. Dorothy was the all-American girl, the kind of that virtuous, hardworking Midwest kind of person. The Cowardly Lion was William Jennings Bryan, who was the Democratic candidate for president in 1900. He was nicknamed the Lion because he would give all of these really fiery speeches, but was also considered cowardly because he did not support America's decision to go to war with Spain in 1898. So whenever he wrote the Cowardly Lion, he didn't have to say the person's name. Everyone kind of knew who he was talking about, though. Scarecrow. The Scarecrow represented the American farmer. And if you think back to the movie, or the book, if you read the book, what was the Scarecrow's problem? The Scarecrow didn't have a brain. So he kind of was saying that, hey, we have all of these farmers who year after year after year are doing the same thing. They're taking out loans that they know they're not going to be able to pay off, and their farms are getting foreclosed on in kind of chunks, to the point where they're driving themselves out of business. He kind of said, hey, this was a stupid idea. The Tin Man represented the American industrialist. And if you, again, remember from the movie, what was the Tin Man's problem? He didn't have a heart. So again, I think we can kind of see the tie there that, that heartless industrialist taking the land, getting the banks to take the land, buying it for pennies on the dollar. Let's see, the Munchkins were the poor, tired masses of citizens. The Wizard represented the President of the United States, whose power was ultimately illusionary in controlling anything to do with monetary policy. And then even some other things kind of in the movie, if you think about it, Oz, O-Z, is the abbreviation for an ounce of gold, right? And I said that the country was on the gold standard at the time. The yellow brick road, again, gold bricks. And so think about what happened in the movie. right? Dorothy is faced with all of these problems, and she is told that if you follow the yellow brick road, that everything will work out. So she follows the yellow brick road, effectively follows the gold standard, and gets to the end of the yellow brick road, and what does she find out? Nothing worked out. The wizard said, I can't help you. The Emerald City said, we can't resolve your problem. And so how did she eventually resolve the problem? So if you think to the movie, because that's what most of us probably think about, you say, oh yeah, at the very end of the movie, she clicked her heels together three times. And that got her back home with her family, and everything was great. And what color were those heels? They were those beautiful ruby red slippers. They're in the Smithsonian, by the way, if you actually want to see them. They're available to look at in the Smithsonian in Washington. So ruby red slippers. That's actually a big difference from the book and from the newspaper articles. So the movie wanted ruby red slippers because Technicolor had just come out, right? Movies were black and white. We wanted to show off this ability to make color. And what can you do that best with bright red sparkling shoes? So when they produced the movie, they made them ruby slippers. However, in the book and in the newspaper, they were actually silver slippers. And that's what Frank Baum was writing is it clicked the silver slippers. Silver is the answer. Silver can solve the problems. Frank Baum in his newspaper articles was actually writing about expanding the money supply to not only include the gold standard, but include the silver standard as well, to allow silver to back currency. The United States has a lot of silver, a whole lot of silver. If you remember earlier in the year when we talked about comparative advantages, again, and some of that geographic advantage, the United States has a geographic advantage in silver. And if they were able to use the silver standard as well, it would essentially, in the late 1800s, early 1900s, been equivalent to quantitative easing. It would have been this massive money dump in society because we have so much more commodity that is able to back our currency. And with that, you know, more money is going through society. We would expect inflation, especially because there wasn't a Federal Reserve to control the inflation rate. And we would see that inflation going up, making it easier to pay off debts, making it easier for his constituents to live off the land and survive. So he wrote all of these newspaper articles, and they eventually all got kind of, you know, hashed out, cut out, and weaved together into the book, The Wizard of Oz, and the movie, The Wizard of Oz. And I probably just ruined the movie for anyone, which is fine, because I can't stand that movie. I hate that movie. So now I feel okay ruining it for everyone else, because now every time you watch it, you're going to think, oh my God, this is a movie really totally and completely written about monetary policy. So just kind of wanted to bring that story to a quick close, and then we'll go ahead and move into our last topic on monetary policy, and that's going to be the loanable funds market.
Just wanna go and love is alive, 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 love